And to whom do I have the pleasure of speaking this morning?
Very funny, Brother Beric. That's not how it works. I told you that in confidence.
I apologize, Sister Cassandra. It was a bad joke.
Some of the other knees liked it.
Well, tell them I'm glad they appreciate good humor when they hear it. Rather than answering, Cassandra picks up her untouched, mysterious breakfast pastry. The Temple of Fry, sadly, does not seem to attract skilled chefs into its ranks, and throws it at Brother Beric. The young holy man, quite taken by surprise, and not the most coordinated individual under the best of circumstances, takes the pastry directly to the face. The thin dough coating gives way under the stress of the blow, and some mysterious brown, semi-solid stuff comes oozing out of the android's breakfast onto Beric's robes. He looks down at the mess in mock horror.
I'm sorry, brother. Some of the other knees were deeply offended by that comment.
He takes a moment to put the ruined breakfast on his plate, grabs a napkin, and begins controlling the damage, all with a smile on his face, until he makes eye contact with his new friend. And she's not smiling anymore. Beric pauses. Don't worry about it. I'm not angry or anything. Just a bit of fun.
Yeah, sorry.
It's the other yous, then?
Yeah.
Cassandra Lee looks down at her hands.
They're trying to show me something. I'm not sure I want to see it.
This is Pot Against the Machine.
Pot Against the Machine.
Welcome back to Pot Against the Machine, the only actual play podcast where Seven starved to death because there was an airlock stopping it from eating Nine. I'm your host, and here's everybody. They're all waving their hands.
That's my favorite joke. It never gets old. Hey.
Hello.
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 Let's see, what happened last week? Last week on the program, the party bid farewell to Iden Vey after bringing Brixby back from the dead. And went off with Long Dreamer back to her home in the woods, identified a lot of items, divvied them out, and went to bed, whereupon the magical moth showed Brixby that he was mistaken about his ideas of what exactly happened on that fateful day/days, or however long it was, down in the hole. And after that, he went back to sleep, and the rest of the night passed as normal, and everybody woke up, and everything was fine, and everyone got their spells just as expected, and it was normal.
Mm-hmm.
And then the party went back into the tower, went all the way up to the 8th floor, where they went in a lab that they thought was probably going to have bad stuff in it. Turned out it just had some vampiric mist that had starved to death because no one was giving them anything to suck blood out of. That's where we are now.
Yay!
So, if I remember correctly, we detected magic, didn't find any magic. There's a bunch of barrels that we did or didn't search, and then obviously, yeah, the sad vestiges of the vampiric mist that starved.
Yeah, you didn't crack open any of the barrels. You did check, and there's no magic in here, and it was just a bunch of dried humanoid-shaped blood stains and blood crusting the barrel lids.
Maybe we don't open the barrels? I mean, I feel like if it's a vampire...
Honestly, I think that's what we had decided on.
Yeah, I think we said avoid them.
I'm wondering if the blood was trying to get in, like maybe it had mice or something in there for vampiric mist to feed on. And then we're just going to open it up and it'll be a bunch of dead, you know, vermin or something. Mm-hmm. And I don't want that to be traumatizing for Briggs, who's gone through enough.
So maybe we just let bloody barrels lie and don't open them.
Sounds like a plan.
Well, so that we are in lab 7, and lab 8 is swarm behavior, lab 9 is quasi-gaseous.
Smoke and particle.
Smoke and particle. All right. Yes. All right. Cool.
Yeah. Quasi-gaseous is the one we're in. Yeah.
Yeah.
So, lab 8?
Lab 8, indeed. All right. So, we roinks in?
Let's roinks.
All right. We're going to put a little roinks on it here.
Does Kira want to swarm with bricks? Because she's outside of the room right now. She's going to get locked out when the thing
consensual
goes.
Consensual swarming. Do I have your consent to swarm?
Yes. Right. You have my swarm welcome.
And an auto aid.
Asher aids with a 25, because of course.
Exist? Nope. 9 on the die for a 7. Alwyn does not aid.
Alrighty do, I roll 2 less than Asher's incredible 25 with a 4 off the die for a 23.
With a 23, you're looking at your standard airlock kind of lock where the door's got to be closed and do its switchy-do. It doesn't look like it's trapped, and through that little window you can see a largely empty chamber with some more metal barrels in it up against the southern wall. But the two barrels in here have jagged rents in their side, like they had like acid melt through them or something.
And we can't see anything else in there.
Right.
Alright.
Should I open the door and go in first just because, you know, recent events?
Yeah, but I'm, like, thinking, sorry, I think I might have a spell could maybe help here. So, Kira, if you don't mind, just 1 second before we go in.
With a motion and a word and the rod, Rigsby is going to cast an extended Cloak of Winds, giving Kira 18 minutes of a Cloak of Winds, which the relevant part, because we're about to go into a room that's called Swarm Research, tiny or smaller creatures must succeed at a fortitude save to successfully touch or attack the subject in melee, which is a DC 18 fortitude save. Failure knocks those attackers prone and away 5 feet per subject. Oh, wow, per level of a caster. So it shoots them back like pretty far, 45 feet.
Through the walls.
And it doesn't affect us. Sweet stuff. So now Kira is wearing the wind, as we like to say.
And also, Alwyn, it's like real tight up here, but I'm wondering if like the gust, the wind,
Yes, I can try and get a little further up. Maybe he'll try to squeeze past and swap places with Asher so he can be kind of in a line to the door. And he will take out the wind wand. Which I feel like I don't have much.
And I can still sphere us, too.
Yeah. I got 5 charges left, but that should be enough to get us through 1 or 2 encounters.
Alright, big stuff. Let's open the door.
I'd like to open the door.
Alright, Kira undoes the bulkhead thingy and the wind blows the door open. And you see the room as described before. There's 2 barrels along the southern wall, not featured in Paizo's map, of course. They're there.
Housekeeping, Asher, I don't remember if I did this last app, even though no time has passed. He's got a revolver with mundane round metal cartridges in one hand and a revolver with adamantine. For now, he's going to save the ghost salts and not worry about having them handy.
Can we percept to see additional things, or is there nothing else to see in this room?
Okay, you can do a percept.
It's 21.
One less for a dirty 20. I'm trying to price this right now.
Much lower.
16, Bob.
Let me just check something real quick. Alright, well, Brixby and Kira both make it. Asher doesn't quite make it. In those two barrels, just kind of lying at the bottom, there are these, like, masses of swarming and, like, shimmering tiny little things that it's too hard to see them with the naked eye. Like, you could just tell that there's a bunch of metal things moving. But they're very, like, listless and just kind of hanging out at the bottom of the barrels. They look very bionanite cloud-like, if you remember those from the wreck of the Aurora. But unlike the others, they aren't bursting out and trying to eat you. They're just kind of chilling in the barrels.
Huh. Well, I really want to touch it, like just a bag of rice, you know? That's what I'm envisioning.
Nope. Strongly suggest we leave.
Yeah, I'm just going to quickly detect magic while we're in here. Just make sure there's something else we're not seeing.
Yeah, it looks like there is no Magoo in this particular mister.
So, like, I am wondering, though, and this is, like, I have no desire to fight swarms, right? I'm stating that right now. And limited means to. This is Asher just leaves the room as Brixby is starting. But I'm unclear about how much murder we have to do to remove Joud's ghost.
Oh, snap.
So that is the... I mean, it's like literally... It's kind of triggered, like, the deep completist vibe that I have in myself that I normally try to put to rest when, because of, you know, verisimilitude. So.
When he got his weird vision, like, I don't know, I'm trying to think how Sam described that. If you saw that, like, every string had to be cut, or, like, is there, like, a tipping point where we've destroyed enough stuff that it works?
I think the general idea, and it's hard to, you know exactly, but I think the general idea was that if you hit the critical mass of severing these, like, it'll be enough. You don't have to get every single possible thing, but you don't know exactly how much is enough.
Well, Kira's in a kill everything that moves, maybe, kind of move.
Yeah,
so.
Let's murder him.
Yep. I've changed my mind.
I'm gonna, like, see if maybe there's, like, a spell or something we could do.
You just grab handfuls and throw them in the bag. These things need to breathe.
We have the clasp.
Yeah.
Right. Somebody can use
that. Asher's clasped currently. Does Asher know from encountering nanite swarms if they would count as robots for the purposes of, like, a +2 EMP pistol?
Yeah, I mean, you know they're machines.
Okay. And that was not Time Worn, right?
Right.
Sweet. Cool.
I forgot you got a giant special space gun.
Would they get cover in their barrels if I were to hit them with a lightning bolt?
They get cover, but that doesn't affect for an area of effect. They still...
Doesn't that help?
Interesting.
Wait,
question.
Doesn't that give them like two to their reflex or something?
Oh, does it? It might, yeah.
Can swarms be blinded?
No.
No.
Because that's a single target thing. Unless you're going to like... Yeah.
Well, if it was like glitter dust, which is a AoE. But I guess the individual things in it are what make the save. I was going to say I can glitter dust the barrel.
There's just millions of little glitter dust hitting millions of little nanite eyes at the same time.
All right. I'm going to just light it up and hope that I can move before it gets angry. So I'm going to need you to roll a reflex save. Nanites.
As I reach into my pouch, pull out fur and a glass rod, think about nasty old Marrow, who I got the spell from, and snap it.
All right. Is this both of them have to roll reflex or just the one?
Both is a line.
All right. So for Blue, the one right next to you, that is an 11.
New. No.
And for Red, much better, a 26.
Yes.
Those rolls were about as far apart as you can get on a d20. Almost.
Alrighty. So, lots of ones. Unfortunate. 24 to Blue, 12 to Red.
Alright, and since those are area of effect, they do damage in half. So 18 to Red and 36 to Blue, that's a big old chunk of blue. I think that makes it time to roll for initiative. I think you've kind of forced the issue here. So I'm rolling really well tonight. Come on, object and token layer. You know what layer you're supposed to be. And starting with the northernmost member of the party, what does Alwyn get?
Alwyn rolled a 6 for a 12.
And how about Kira?
It's a 4 for a 10.
And Asher.
Woohoo. Feeling real quick. 8 for a 13.
Fastest so far.
We all rolled garbage.
18 for a 25, because he is right beside the swarms and spooked.
Well, that's good for Brixby, given his physical position. And Brixby is definitely first in initiative here.
So Brixby is going to grab the necklace that Brixby wore, that he took with him. And he's going to tell his brother that he needs him now, which is what he does every time. So he grabs it.
I need you.
And he snaps another glass fur combination, and I need you to roll another reflex save as I use my bonded amulet.
I don't like it. We'll start with Blue again, since it's right next to you. That is a 16.
That is a fail.
And much better for Red once more. That is a 26.
That is a pass. That makes sense. It's like Blue's absorbing all the lightning bolt for Red, really. So let me just roll another. Hopefully there's less ones this time. A little bit less. All right, that is 27. So half again would be, 13 on top of that. So 40 to Blue. And then 13 plus 7, 19 to Red. And then I am going to jet north.
All right, well, you fried Blue before it could even get out of the barrel. Red's not looking great either, but it did pass both those saves, so it's a little bit better off. That was pretty mean. Red is up next, so it is going to float on out. And I think since Asher is the first one it sees as it comes out, and it no longer can tell who exactly was frying it, it's just going to swarm on into Asher's square, which means... Cool. What is this? 3d6 damage. A 10 damage. And then you need to make a will save.
And that was what type of damage?
That was swarmy swarm damage. Untyped.
Okay, well, they're robots. I didn't know if it was like electricity.
Not. They don't give it a type. It's just charm damage.
Does a 27 suit you okay on that will save?
Yeah, you're not fascinated, rather. How about a fortitude save real quick?
Just a little, okay, now you're just making stuff up.
Just a little 40 do.
I'm much less confident with an 18.
That's still enough. The DC on the fortitude save is not high. So even though it feels like they're like expertly biting at your nerves and like something would happen, it doesn't happen just because you save all the time. And it's your turn.
Oh, cool. Asher's going to take a 5-foot step out of the swarm. And then just do a full attack, rapid shot. Their touch is going to be higher than normal creatures we encounter, so I'm not going to do deadly aim. But I do have the swarm bane clasped. One's not looking so great. A 16 against touch.
16 will not hit.
Sorry, I mathed really bad because I'm like, 14 plus 4 is 16. It was an 18 was my lowest.
18 will not hit either.
Okay. So the others were a 29 and a 25.
Yeah, those both hit.
Sweet. So 2d8 coming at you. If it matters, I do have... will be doing damage.
You do be doing damage.
A total of 10.
Alright. Not nothing. It would be nothing, but it's not because of the thing.
Yay. End of turn.
Alright. Alwyn.
Alwyn was gonna cast resistance on Asher for helping with his rolls on that. You know, he can actually still technically do that because it's a swarm, so I'm assuming it doesn't have AoEs. Yeah. Or not AoEs, AoOs. So he is just going to do a little circle around Kira here to get next to Asher, and he's going to cast resistance on him to give him +1 on his saves if it tries to do that again.
Hasn't he heard that resistance is futile?
Thank you.
cut this up. This is just a question that I want to know. Is my new meteor AoE?
I think it gets a 5-foot square. Yes, it is. I'm an idiot. I should.
No, I mean, you're helping your buddy. And
if it's still
good
alive
RP.
Next time, I'll do it. Yeah, I feel like he's kind of fallen into like that helper role. So he's thinking more of like, I'm going to keep Asher up than he is of trying to attack
it. I get that. For sure.
All right, that'll bring Kira up.
I don't think I can do anything with a regular sword, right? I just be slashing at the air.
Right. If only you had some kind of force fang ring.
So close. Okay, so I think I'm gonna do nothing. Can I cheer on my friends? I would like to roll to cheer.
You can aid Asher's attack.
I'll do that. Great. I will aid. Kira will say, "You can do it, Asher. Here's a sticker." And that'll be my turn. Do I need to roll to aid? What is that?
Yes, but your attack bonus is better than +10, so it's just don't roll a 1.
Okay. Whew, that's a 2.
Oh, so swarms are totally not, unless that swarm is a special one, swarms are not immune to physical damage. They just take half.
It just depends on if it's tiny or fine or diminutive. It changes based on size category.
Yeah, since this one's fine, it's...
Oh, yeah, diminutive or immune.
It's immune to web.
Yeah, fine and diminutive. Okay. Yeah. Okay.
All right.
And Zach was right. They are immune to single target spells.
Brixby, you're...
I'm useless. Sorry.
Brixby, you're back up.
Thank you. I'm useless here at this point. I'm out of zappies and doobies, so I'm going to walk on over to swarm with my buddy Alowin, and I too am going to attempt to aid my friend Asher's attack. It's not a gimme for me, but I did get 13, which is enough to do it.
Asher getting that big plus 4 on his next attack. But before that happens, the swarm gets another turn, so it's going to try to swarm Kira. Now what happens when it flies into this wind?
Roll a fortitude save.
Going to roll a swarmitude save. How's an 11 treat you?
An 11 is a very fail. So, this means that you are knocked prone, for whatever that means for you as a swarm, and you are pushed back 45 feet. And you also take 3d6 points of non-lethal damage plus 1d6 if you hit a solid movement. So 4d6 points of non-lethal.
Alright, who wants to roll that? Non-lethal doesn't affect...
That's what I thought, right? It doesn't affect
constructs, so it doesn't matter.
Yeah, okay, cool. But
so
you
probably
got
it did crunch a bunch of nanites, and they didn't get to do any damage, but mostly it was just funny to see the things fly away. And Asher, please execute these.
Asher will attempt to execute those with a... Feeling emboldened with the aid, we'll just go ahead and aid plural to aid. He will make 3 deadly aim shots. Excessive? Probably. with the aids, the lowest is a 25, so I think that hit last time. We are good. Looking at 33 points of damage.
And that is enough to execute the swarms. It's the last of the bio-nanites goes tumbling to the floor. And the swarm research lab is clear.
I think you get a grit point back for each nanite, so I've got so many temporary grit points.
Thousands of grit points.
So you just...
Also, like in Diablo 2, as they die, suddenly there's loot that we didn't see when they were flying around, just laying on their bodies.
Yeah, the cloud of flies. All of a sudden, the scimitar flies out of it.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Is there anything, like, in the barrels where they were?
Looks like the barrels were nanite storage barrels that they ate their way out of.
Interesting. So there's like no notes in here, no sign of. It was Lab 7 that had the snarky note that's like, we're not running a slaughterhouse here or whatever, right?
Yeah, Lab 7.
Because that was the vampiric mist.
100-pound limit
enough is the one of the things starved to death.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But they were just that makes a lot of sense. Okay, cool. So,
well, that was, I don't want to jinx us, but a bit easier than I expected it to be. That leaves one more. And perhaps those robot wizards, whoever they are.
Yes. Let's go down to this smoking particle research. Perhaps it's barbecue.
Yes. So what smoke am I smelling? Is it like the delicious apple wood? Is it like a mesquite, perhaps a hickory?
It's a little bit of a hickory with notes of like a rosewood.
Ooh. That's interesting.
Fancy. It's fancy, fancy stuff.
I'll tell everyone I'm an applewood chips guy myself. That is my fave. Although I will get down with some of the other ones.
I assume for smoked mushrooms.
How much room is in this one? Is this just a one by two?
Yeah, it's a one by two with two kind of tiny mini pieces of squares there. If you want to absolutely shovel your way in there, I'd say it's allowable. Very uncomfortable, though.
I stuck on.
Mechanically squeezing.
Oh, I'm stuck on the corner of that thing.
All right. perhaps the last roinks in this tower? What do I know?
Oh, wait, no. Have minus two. I don't need. I'm like, yeah, I rolled double digits.
30 to right. 8.
22 to 8.
Excellent. Hopefully I can exceed those fantastic rolls. I can with a 33. Our powers combined, the 12 off the die.
Once again, no locks, no traps. You can see in here several shelves, desks running along the side, and you see a familiar creature. You saw some of these in the basement. A set of dull red eyes, grasping claws, and wet, leathery wings, and then like a kind of smoky body. Looks like there's a Belker in there. It looks like a beefy Belker.
That Belker's been bulking.
Nothing's worse than a bulking Belker.
We got a bulk Belk.
If we want Shoud to never return,
Asher spins six fresh mundane rounds into his revolver.
Kill them all.
And the music that we totally licensed from Metallica starts playing in the background. And we rolled and we did just all right on our knowledge rolls on these things, right?
Yeah, I think you got the sort of general weird air elemental flying creature can go.
Yeah,
it can try to climb into your lungs, but it couldn't because you were wearing the masks.
Oh yeah, and we've got those activated. Alright, let's...
Were they... I'm trying to remember if they were... Because they're air elementals, but were they solid, or were they...
They're normally solid, but they can go kind of smoky.
Yeah, because I remember they can go into your lungs, so I couldn't remember what the heck they were. Like, I'm trying to think how easy they are to hit. So do we want to haste?
Yeah, let's haste.
Okay.
So, Alwyn will cast haste on the party.
And then somebody throws the door open, I presume?
Not after we gotta take a rip of this haste paste goo tube that we have. Delicious.
But you have to spend 4 rounds trying to squeeze the last of the goo out of the tube.
Find, gotta like, go a pen fast,
to wrap
Sam.
It around. So opening up the door. Why won't it do it? There we go. And now pop this on the right layer. We're gonna go right into initiative as you go into this horrible laboratory. So I can't start with the farthest north because everyone is literally on the same level and it's really mean. So I'm going to start with the Belker because the Belker's going to go first probably. Alright, I'll start with Asher because I can see him. And then I'll go to Alan because I can see him.
Emboldened by that nanite kill, he faces this Belker with a cloud of hundreds of grit points. And I rolled a total of a 22.
bad. How about Alowyn?
Alowyn rolled a 9 for a 15.
And Kira?
11 for a 17.
And Brixbow once more.
17 for a 24.
So much for the Belker going first. It's going to be Brixby first again.
So this thing's solid, so I could sneak attack it, theoretically.
You could theoretically sneak attack it. One would theorize.
One would theorize. Alrighty. Welp. It's sneako attacko time, because I am going to point and shoot out 2 Scorching Rays. Is there like a spell resistance sitch here, or are we good?
What was the question, sorry?
Is there spell resistance that I have to worry about
no.
at all? Oh, excellent. All right. So this is roll number 1. So, wow, 16 for a 23 versus touch and flat-footed touch.
That will hit.
And numero dos is only an 11 off a die for an 18 versus flat-footed touch.
Yeah, the number you're trying to hit is a 9, so yeah.
Excellent. Do you want fire and sneak attack separately, or is together cool?
They can go together.
Rolling a lot of this specific number. Oh, come on. All right, so the first one is 23 points, and the second one is 28.
Jeez. Total of 51 damage?
Yes.
It's a lot of damage.
And if, I guess everyone can see it, but Brixby's going to shout, "It's a Belka, it's a Belka, it's a Belka."
We had a baby, it's a Belker.
It's a bulk Belk. And that's my turn.
Alright, Asher, you two are up before the bulky Belker.
Ah, indeed. The bulky Belker beckons. So, Asher can see some of the Belker from where he is now. Granted, there's like an Alowyn and a Brixby and wall in the way, so I'm going to guess there'd be a non-zero amount of cov. But I think Asher could just put one hand, you know, he'll kind of try and block Alowyn's ear with the left hand revolver so it's not as loud as he places the right hand revolver much too close for comfort to the side of his head, and then we'll just swift action focus his aim as he does unleash 3 rapid shot deadly aim focused aim bullets. Emboldened by the meta knowledge that the number I'm looking for is 9, I can say with confidence all 3 of those resulted in a hit. So I'm going to roll 3d8 plus 33. That is 44 points of damage.
And the big bad bulky Belker goes bust. Before it even gets a turn.
I'm not ready for a Belker arc. I really don't want a Belker arc in between books.
Luckily, Belkers aren't interesting enough to merit their own arc.
Nakorocho Beldalora. And yeah, the grip point just comes right back.
Animated Crane arc, on the other hand. Just you wait for the City of Cranes.
The young man named Ichabod.
Didn't we fight a... Didn't we fight a daemon that we killed before it did
That's
anything
true.
To?
Mm-hmm. We've got a laundry list of your crimes that have to be resolved in horrible side quests.
Action economy crimes.
So Yeah, now that you have free reign of this room, you can see several shelves and desks running along the northern and western walls, while in the center stands a contraption made of several concentric metal rings arrayed around a thin metal mesh, in which is cradled a black ceramic bottle with a cork plugging its top.
What's that bottle?
Is it magic?
Looks like magic.
Is it magic or tech?
The thing it's in is some kind of machine, but the bottle itself appears to be magic.
He will walk up next to Brixby, which luckily I already have him next to Brixby on the map. And that is an 11 on the die for a 29.
You are indeed looking at an ever-smoking bottle. Zach, would you like to do the honors of telling everyone what an ever-smoking bottle is, or do you want me to...
Basically, it's like a instant obscuring mist, if I remember correctly, which for me, in addition with that spell that I learned, Ashen Path, that I can cast on us, means that we can have crazy concealment sneak attack debacle at will that also doesn't use a spell slot.
Now, is it a certain number of times a day, or can you just use that literally whenever you feel like it?
Is it an ever-smoking bottle or an often-smoking bottle? Because if it's ever, then it should be infinite.
Well,
it's actually just a really old...
Just going to pull this bad boy up.
It's gone bad.
I don't see in the item description a limit to uses.
Nope. Yeah, there isn't. There isn't one.
That's
so
wild.
So, nice. So you could literally use it like every combat in a row all day long.
Yeah. So this metal urn is identical in appearance to an Efreeti bottle. For folks who don't know, Efreetis are fire genies in Pathfinder, except all it does is smoke. The amount of smoke is great if the stopper is pulled out, pouring out of the bottle and totally obscuring vision across a 50-foot spread in one round. The bottle is left unstoppered. The smoke billows out another 10 feet per round until it has covered a 100-foot radius. This area must remain smoke-filled until the ever-smoking bottle, or the area remains smoke-filled until the ever-smoking bottle is stoppered. The bottle must be resealed by a command word, after which the smoke dissipates normally. Moderate wind will disperse it in four rounds. A strong wind will do it in one. Very cool.
Oh, this is amazing. This is this plus the thing that I can do where we can see through the smoke at the winery with the ill-fated smoke and the whatnot. This is a Jared. Beautiful beast. I hate you, but...
Brixby holds the bottle. Does anyone mind if I hold this?
Yes, you make the most sense for it.
Yeah, enjoy.
Oh, yeah.
Brixby takes a huge rip of his ever-smoking bottle. I'm kidding. I'll leave it up to the editor if that is allowed for our PG-13.
I'm pretty sure this is mine, and it's staying in.
Yeah, I've got the next one. 32.
Now, I'm just imagining it as one of those, like, ridiculously overwrought glass pipes they sell at, like, gas
stations. Oh, yeah, absolutely. Redolent with skulls. Because he's such an edgelord, too. It's going to have, like, skulls and other things on it.
Chains standing off of it.
Brix's tent will be a hookah lounge forever.
Yeah. Brix is now at least 15% more down with the clown, whether he knows it or not. The ownership of a weird bong bottle. What about
this machine that it's in? Asher, do you want to come take a look?
Sure. Looks like a...
And he got a 29 on knowledge engineering.
That is enough to identify this contraption as... some sort of turbine that looks like when it spun, it would generate like a spherical cage of wind around like where those rings are, containing and manipulating the air and vapor within the sphere where the bottle was. So like presumably the ever smoking bottle, when open, when the thing was on, like the smoke would just continuously pour out into this ball and make like a super smoky ball for some reason.
So Brixby's going to smoke weed out of that, I guess. But we're just going to keep...
It does look like the Belker has done quite a bit of damage to this turbine, so it is not currently clambake ready.
Well, let's take the time to repair it. It seems important to you, Brixby.
Yeah, it's like really important that I like. I feel like what Xiao really wants us to do, and he just pulls out his like vape pen and starts like blowing big, disgusting smelling clouds. We're gonna cut this all out because I'm probably gonna offend the vaping contingency.
I am offended. Thank you.
I'm pretty sure Brixby canonically rips cotton just all the time.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, you know, art does imitate life just a little bit. So,
well, I mean, this is honestly a treasure. Was certainly worth coming in here and just mashing the heck out of this big bulk Belka.
Yes, and as much as it would be entertaining to attempt to repair this second stage turbine blade, it being broken just might help further disconnect Showard from this tower, so I suppose we can leave it in disrepair.
Was there anything else on the shelves that was interesting?
Looks like that was the extent of the interesting things in this room.
Shall we go see if there are robot wizards above us?
Okay.
Sure.
Right.
Alright, I'm going to drag you all over to the new layer now, so don't move your tokens.
Everybody keep moving.
Everyone stop moving your tokens.
I've stopped.
Izzy didn't stop moving.
I've stopped moving my token.
You moved it right back after I moved it.
Oh, well, okay, that was a slow load issue then. That's not on my account.
No, I have to publicly put you on token moving blast. So coming up the final set of stairs in the choking tower brings you to a large chamber with a tall conical roof. A tangled mass of whistling pipes run from the floor of the room and up through the ceiling. Colored smoke issuing from the central core of pipes pervades the room, giving everything a hazy sheen. Tables throughout are covered with bubbling cauldrons, smoking alembics, and delicate mechanical contraptions. Three large tanks filled with colored fog stand on the north side of the room. Elsewhere, large metal bookshelves are crammed with books and papers. Now, in this room, in addition to things I just described to you, are these two... I'll pop them up for you. They look like slim gearsmen almost, except that where their shoulders meet their arms, they got a little Kasatha action going. They've got four arms. In addition, they have golden like face masks, and then they're wearing cool stylish cloaks, and they just look like generally cool guys. Two of them. Cool non-gendered guys, I would say. They are hard at work doing something, toiling away at their desks as you come up the stairs.
They don't notice our non-stealthy approach?
They seem to be hard at work.
I want to attack them. Just for funsies.
That's mean.
Wait,
did you say the smoke up here is like concealment level smoky? Or is it like flavor smoke?
It's more flavor smoke. It's not really thick enough to do a concealy do.
Unfortunate, because thick smoke is one of my favorite goo tubes. So we'll have to just go with this delicious flavored smoke.
Yeah. Okay. Asher licks the air with a 15 perception. What flavor is this smoke?
This particular smoke is more of like, it's weird. It's like a calorie pear, which you didn't even know people made smoke in that flavor. seems irresponsible.
Calories.
Calories.
Yeah. Yes. I prefer to have them in 100 calorie packs so I can ration off the enjoyment. Anyway, should we murder them?
Yeah, let's murder.
Do we want to try and trick them or something and so we can get a full round of attacks in?
I definitely think I can. Yeah, you.
Yeah, I was going to say, I can cast Murderous Command on one of them and make him attack the other one before we even start doing anything.
Go muck about their robot heads. Their robo-ponces.
I think since you are talking within earshot of these, the blue one who's closer to the top of the stairs will sort of stop what it's doing and start heading your way, sort of walking over towards you, and it says, "Has Master Xiao extracted the android's lore yet? Does he require our aid?"
Master Xiao is still hard at work. You may continue with your duties.
Do you want to bluff on that?
Yeah, that would be good.
Sorry, gang, that's a 2 on the dice. 4 and 11.
It's honestly on brand.
The robot, like, is looking at Asher, and obviously it has literally no features on its face, so it has no facial expression. It is a blank golden slab, and it says, "You are lying to us. What have you done with Master Shoud?"
Pull his head out the bag. No,
quick, scramble them robo brains.
Asher will walk closer to the robot, because right now he has a terrible line of sight. And if the robot doesn't stop him, he'll just hold his, hold his revolvers up, but still hold his hands up.
"Oh, well, we send him away. They need, even the greatest of wizards needs rest every now and again."
And that's not a lie.
So I think the robots are not buying your particular brand of bluffing, or deception in this case. And the second robot starts heading your way. I think it's time to roll for initiative.
Now, if I was smart, me the player, I would have said I would ready to use that ability if I noticed them not believing Asher, but I didn't. I think I finally got a decent,
Yeah, me too.
Initiative.
All right. Are we still hasted?
No, that only lasted a few rounds.
Probably not. That's a minute of... around. Is it a round
level? Yeah, it's round a level.
Otherwise, it would be monstrous.
Round a level, yeah, then it's definitely gone. Yeah. It's definitely gone.
Oh, I had him outside the building.
I'm trying to find Brixby.
I'm right here.
Your turn.
I didn't go anywhere.
And there was an alloy on top of you. So,
yeah, he threw Kira out of the building.
What did Asher get?
He couldn't bluff his initiative roll either. Don't worry, it makes sense. That is a total of a 13. Back to where we started.
All right, that's not very fast. How about Kira?
Switched dice, got an 18 for a 24.
That's pretty fast.
Yeah.
How about Alowyn?
Alowyn got a 16 for a 22.
And Brixby, last on the initiative question, but probably with a high number.
Middle of the pack with a 17, 10 off the die.
Okay. Well, there's good news and bad news. The good news is one of them rolled worse than all of you. The bad news is one of them rolled better than all of you. So, the red robot is headed over in your general direction. And it is going to... It's gonna drop a stinking cloud.
No.
Stinky cloud.
But our poison is delayed, and we're wearing a mask.
Yep.
So, the good thing about that is that you're not poisoned, you're not nauseous. You do still have the obscured sight. Also, each of you takes... that is not the right die. 4 points of electric damage. And one point of force damage.
I feel like some of us don't.
As this spell weirdly carries this odd, like, electromagnetic force to it as the energy converges on you. So, a little bit of a shock, a little bit of a forcey do.
Does that do anything to your
range? How much force did you say?
1 point.
That's an interesting question. If it's an incoming force effect, if it's not considered a force spell or force spell-like ability, then it wouldn't charge it.
Yeah, it's not considered a force spell. It's just a strange extra thing.
Neat.
Just a little bit of fun for the robot.
I sure took a point of force damage, and it seems otherwise unfazed.
Same with Alwyn. He also does not seem phased at all by the electricity.
Well, it's of both of them. And
Kira's
up.
Cool. Kira on her first chance to attack in like an hour. Gonna mosey on up to blue. In the direction of blue, I guess. Let's see. So my speed is halved because I can't see. Is that correct? Am I making that up?
You're not technically blind, but...
But does it count as difficult terrain, though? Because that would have her speed.
It doesn't count as difficult terrain.
Though. Yeah, I think it's only the that other one that Zaud had that does difficult terrain. That, yeah,
solid fog, and then he had the grippy smoky
thing. Yeah.
Well, I'm going to shimmy on up to blue. And can I squeeze into this spot next to him? Is that enough room, or do I need to be... I don't want to cut off Asher.
Yeah, you can fit there.
Cool. And then I'm going to hit it with a chainsaw. Oh, I'm going to rage. I'm going to rage as I... The old rage and walk. It's not great. That's a 10 on the die for a 29. Right? Yeah,
29,
that's how it works.
To hit, that will hit.
10.
What weapon are you using?
I'm using chainsaw.
Okay.
Points of chainsaw damage at red.
Alright, it doesn't seem to all go through, but, you know, it's still a high number.
Okay. I am hasted, but I moved, so I don't think I can never remember. I don't think I get my second attack, because that would be a full round.
Not if you move.
Can I intimidate a robot? Or
you
demoralize it, rather?
Try.
Okay, I'm going to try that.
Well, I don't know. They're immune to mind.
Oh, never mind.
So you can try.
I won't
but
do
it
that.
Won't do anything.
Yeah, unless you're a weirdo.
That's cool. All right, that is me. I think. I feel like I'm forgetting something. Gonna regret it. All right, go for it. Someone else. I'm gonna stop talking.
All right. Alwyn.
Question, because my brain is mush from my antibiotics. Casting a spell, it's not like a ranged attack, right? Like, I can't cast if I have partial concealment from the mist. Is that correct? Or is it a mist?
With full concealment, you can't cast a target.
I can't cast a targeted spell at all, correctly? Correct. Yeah, okay, that's what I thought. Then I think his move then will just be to get within sight of, quote-unquote, sight.
As a swift action, he will take out his wand that lets him blow stuff away. And as his standard action, he will cast haste again so that Brix and Asher and he are all hasted.
All right. And Brixby.
Brixby's going to cast the spell that he's so excited to cast because he really hasn't been able to use this, like, very arcane trickstery spell. He's going to pull out, I mean, it's the same as, like, the low-level version of it, but he's going to pull out a really big eyelash and a really big thing of gum arabic, and he's going to greater invisibility. So he is now very invisible, and now hasted, he is going to move into the room, putting him, I'm just going to say he's going to kind of walk forward and probably stop on the spot right here, which puts him right near all of the pikes.
That's not very nice at all. It's not great either.
I put my ninja invisibility thing on my character on here. There we go.
Alright. And that'll bring us to Asher.
Asher.
Robots, you have to assume they're all gone.
No. Even though we talked and Asher was like, oh man, does it seem like those robots would be, swarms would be affected by the EMP pistol that I have? We're going to go fight some robots. Jeff, the player, isn't smart enough to have said that Asher has that pistol. He has a revolver in each hand. No problem. He is going to spread on over towards the west, try and hug that wall with his hastiness, drop the revolver that had mundane rounds. As he walks, draws the plus two EMP pistol, so now he has an EMP pistol in one hand and a revolver full of adamantine rounds in the other. And he glares at this red robot, whom he can now see, because he hurt his friends. And Asher will, as a swift action, vindictively smite it, and then fire off a single deadly aim EMP shot. That's a 24 against touch.
24 will hit touch.
Okay, that is going to be, let's see, 2d6 plus 2 plus 4, so 2d6 plus 6. Ooh, 6 and a 5. So 17 points of cool EMP damage. And then do you have to make a save of some kind? Or is that only if I crit?
Let me check the item description, which I happen to have ready. It's only on a crit.
Sweet. Then, yeah, 17 points of any DR bypassing damage.
And that does more than one would normally expect it to do, which is always fun. And the robot didn't like it. The robot is going to have words for it.
Will Asher be smarter than Brixby and roll a knowledge engineer out?
No. Okay, fine. only a 23.
I don't think, given the rarity of these particular creatures, that that's going to be enough. So, you know, they're magic robots.
Pretty cool.
So, that'll take us to Blue. And what Blue is going to do, since Kira is right up in its face, is it's going to just take a 5-foot step sort of back and into its little workbench here where it feels safe. And then it's going to drop just a nice little web. Basically the same place that the stinking cloud was dropped. So, but like a little bit more to the right so it hits Kira because it knows where Kira is. So, electric damage for Kira and Alolint, that's 3 points. And 5 points of force damage for Kira and Alolint. Yeah. And since this is a web, I am going to need reflex saves from both Kira and Alolint.
That is a 24 for Alolint.
Alolint passes.
A dirty 20 for Kira.
Kira also passes, so you are not currently stuck in the web. You're not grappled, but you are still in difficult terrain. As spider webs, electromagnetic spider webs, no less, are basically stuck to the floor, they're stuck to the walls. They're trying to be stuck to you, but they're not really succeeding. They're trying. They wish they could be stuck to you. That'll take us to Red Robot, who is going to just... on the drawing tool. It's going to take a 5-foot step up to Asher, because Asher shot it. And it knows that shooting means close up. And it has a special thing that it can do against people who like to hit from far away. And that is punching 4 times. So it's going to turn on power attack, and it's going to go for the slams. Let me just check what its fab is real quick. Not small. Going to miss on the first one with a 17 to hit. Second one is a cracked die. How does a 34 sound?
Oof, just barely.
That's 14 damage from slam number 2.
And it's just physical bludge.
Yeah, it's just bludgeoning, just a little slam to do. 28 on slam number 3.
Yeah, even with the smite plus, that still hits.
That is 15 slammy dammy. And the final slam, because it does have 4 arms, is only 22 to hit.
Because of the smite deflect bonus, that does not hit.
Alright, that's very sad. It's mean and sad and mean. But, it's done and Kira is up.
Alright. Well, here goes my plan, as I suspect you knew, to take a 5-foot step and full attack. Like you were ready for it or something, so I'm going to take a not 5-foot step and wiggle out of this difficult webby area to stand south left of blue and go again south with left. A chainsaw. Yeah. Consistency, Sam. We're professionals. And that's a 1. So, not my knight. I guess it's a 20? Does a 20 do anything? I don't think it matters. Does it matter if I get a 1?
Yeah. It doesn't matter. It's an auto miss.
Yeah. Okay. Well, that was fun. And I don't get to swing again. So again, I will slink into obscurity. I'm not even going to say the words right, team. I'm going to just put myself in mute. Except for motorcycles.
You can ride your motorcycle. It's okay if you want. It's your biker appeal that really brought you into this group in the first place as a resident bad boy.
All right. Well, that'll take us to Alolint. Alolint, the world is the stickiest it's ever been.
Yeah. Well, noticing that everybody else has walked out of the fog, it is no longer worth wasting a charge of this wand. So he is going to... let's see. That's 15, so that's my extent of my movement with the double move through the nastiness. He steps out and he sees...
Anyone moving through the web, I forgot to do this on Kira's turn, but it was also almost certainly trivial. Must make a combat maneuver check or escape artist check as part of their move action, or you'll become grappled as you try to move through the web.
BMB is lovely. Escape artist is that? Oh, escape artist is minus two, so I'm going to take the plus four CMB instead. <No. laughs> that is a 13.
Meets beats.
So there's a nine on the die. I'm like, there's no way this is going to, I'm going to be stuck in here. I have a seven strength, everybody.
They have bad DCs.
Yeah, so
at least
he does manage to force his way out of the web, and it's probably very embarrassing. He goes, a lot, but he gets out, and then, you know what, he's angry about this, because he was the only person back there when they cast that second spell, so he's going for the high-level things. Make me a will save, blue robot.
Blue robot will save. How's a 22 sound?
That beats it. Blue robot is not trapped in a mind maze. That is his turn.
Alright. Brixby, no one knows where you are.
Brixby, looking at the two situations, Brixby is going to move north and then west, the complement of his 40 feet, because he's not top his disc today. I didn't say it in the last episode, so holding myself to it. And with full line of sight on Red Robot, who is assailing his buddy Asher, Brixby is going to fire into melee. So I got a plus two from being invisible, but a negative four from firing into melee. So that is a net negative two on my rolls here. That is a nine versus flat-footed touch.
That will miss, surprisingly.
And let's try that again. Hopefully I roll higher than a 3 this time. I did. I rolled a 17 for a 23 versus flat-footed touch.
23 will hit.
All right. And would you like sneak attack and fire damage separately?
Yeah. Why don't we do that?
All right. And is there any sort of spell resistance or anything else going on here?
No, nothing like that.
Excellent.
They cast the spells, they don't resist them.
All right, that is 13 points of fire damage and 16 points of sneak attack.
All right.
And I'm going to roll a knowledge engineering. Do that real quick here. 27. So that's only a 9 for a 26.
So that is enough to know at least that these are robotic apprentices, which are extremely rare robots, seen almost never outside of Starfall. They're generally employed by the Technic League as kind of baby spellcasters. They learn some, pick up some rudimentary spellcasting ability, and then otherwise, you know, they function like robots, and they have reasonable intelligence and are able to think for themselves, solve problems, and accomplish tasks. In this case, the task might be killing all of you. Sadly, 26 is not enough for any questions.
Alright, Brixby's not going to give out his location by shouting, they're robot apprentices. That's my turn.
Alright, Asher, you got a robot in your face.
Yeah, Asher misspoke. Weirdly, his damage no longer bypasses DR, but he also forgot to include the plus six damage from the deadly aim. So, yeah, we'll call it even. He will take a 5-foot step to the northwest. There's a swift action, spend a grip point to focus his aim, and will then unleash a hasted rapid shot, full attack, deadly aim, vindictively smote, focused aim, 4 shots. So the last one, the lowest one, I'll just start there because it's always fun for the listeners, is only a 18 against touch.
18 does hit touch.
Okay, then. So we are going to have 4 instances of 2d6 plus... Hold on, I can math. I'm going to roll it and roll 20. And it's going to be... So 8d6 plus... So you got plus 2, plus 2, plus 12... Plus 17,
34, 68. Oh my god. Now, is that accounting?
So that just kills both of them, right?
Somehow. Is that accounting for the vulnerability to electricity?
No, sir. That's 96 robot. Points of damage.
Red robot falls down and doesn't get back up. So. Shimmering magical crit point. Flies back over to Asher.
And as it does, he's holding this EMP pistol in one hand, and it's kind of starting to heat up from the rapid shots. And he just sort of shouts out into the nothingness, "One apprentice down, Shoud!" And that's the end of his turn.
Would you say he shouted that out?
He let it all out.
Shout.
Well, I think Blue heard you. Blue's not super happy about that. But it's got a good thing going. It's going to take a 5-foot step to the north away from the mean half-orc with the chainsaw. And I'm just going to get my circle tool out again, as it just is going to splop some grease on the place where Kira is standing. So, Kira... 2 electric damage, 3 force damage, and you're out of the sticky and into the greasy. So you're gonna have to make acrobatics checks to move is what happens. And it's your turn.
Great. I am so good at acrobatics, fortunately. Let's see what happens if I try and do this on a different die. Hey, that's a nat 20. Minus 2, though, so 18.
All right, you are able to successfully walk in the grease without falling down.
Is it still difficult terrain, or if I take a 5-foot step? Sam!
No 5-foot steps in the grease. It's almost like these guys are designed to not let you do that.
Yeah, no, I'm seeing what's happening here. Really following through on the strategy. I am going to step out of the grease, though, and just do a regular chainsaw. Hopefully some damage this. I just want to hit a thing. Unbelievable. I shouldn't have said anything. That's another one, so I will chill over here.
Wow.
That's my turn, Sam.
That's cool. But you got right up in its face.
Yeah, mean. That's been helpful.
Alowyn.
Do these things have the robotic equivalent of bones in them?
I don't think we can really call what they have robo-bones.
In that case, you know what? He's just going to try to confuse it. Make me a...
only a 15.
That is a fail. Unfortunately, I only have lesser confusion, but that is still for the next round it is confused.
Oh, fun. Alright. Are you moving anywhere? Jumping into the grease?
No, he's fine where he is.
Heading for the confluence of the grease, the web, and the stink?
Yeah, no, he's going to go into this square over here where all three of them are overlapping.
Just the worst square in all of Pathfinder?
Yeah.
All right, Brixby. No one can see
all right.
you. You can
no one can
run
see
away.
Me, so I'm going to shuffle back on the other side of the pipe and fire into melee again. With the same sitch. So that is a 16 versus touch and an 11 versus touch.
That'll be one hit.
All right. For fiery. Definitely rolled this before. I know. Good luck finding me. This is what I was like laughing about. I'm like, how are you going to strike me as the last creature that struck you? So it's 12 points of fire damage and 16 points of sneak attack.
That either. Alright. It's hurt. It's confused. Turn. Doesn't know where that came from. Asher, you're up. You just melted the very valuable robot into slag.
Sweet. Except it doesn't do fire damage, so I think it's still fine.
Electromelt.
Last time I specifically talked about not damaging a robot with a crit, he still said I damaged it, so I know better than to try and pick this fight. Talk to me about these pipes, Sam. Are they like floor to ceiling? Can Asher even see Kira and Old Blue over there?
I mean, these pipes aren't just floor to ceiling. They're floor and out the roof. So Asher has, like, I think it's not totally solid barrier, so he can kind of see Alolan and maybe sort of see where, at least where Kira is, if not, like, actually get a good view of the situation. He's going to have to run into the greasy, stinky webs, I think.
Forever. I mean, hard disagree on the have-to part.
He has to. It's Europe. There's nothing
Hasted Fastman.
I am so Hasted Fastman. So haste gives you what? Like 300 feet to your speed? 40? Yes.
It doubles it, I think. So if you had 30, you have
60. 60, and then...
Which I totally forgot about when I said I was at the extent of my movement before.
Yeah, so 30, 30 feet, and then, yeah, so Asher can get all the way around the pipes. He doesn't know where Brixby is, but he was kind of going around the back of the room anyway to 20 feet north of Kira. He has plenty of range on this 50-foot range EMP pistol, Chef Kiss. This creature is not smote, but he will spend a swift to focus. Yeah, it's just one shot. We'll just do a single deadly aim. We'll save the time.
Does the laser thing just automatically come on, or is it like a choice?
It's a battery activation. For that plus one, I think it lasts like an hour, probably like everything seems to. It's really convenient, but I haven't been factoring in the plus one because I never said I flicked it on. So Hasted Fastman will take a single deadly aim shot. And that is a dirty 20 against touch, so we got it. Only 13 points of damage, but it is electric. Boogie, boogie, woogie.
So it does more than it should. It also does the wonderful thing of giving the robot someone to attack that it can actually see.
Yeah, come at me, bro.
Since it's confused, it is going to head up to Asher, which will provoke an attack of opportunity from Kira if she would like to try to chop it into bits before the confused robot even punches her friend once.
That is a... Wait for it. I can do this math. Dirty 30 to hit. Obviously, it's a filthy 30. That doesn't make sense. They're all dirty. Just like the rhymes.
A clean 30.
Okay. That is going to be... 6, 12, 32 points of chainsaw damage.
All right, doesn't seem to all go through.
Yeah, yeah.
It's still a chunk. Yeah, it's Kira doesn't seem to all go through. Smith. Oh.
Smile.
You'd think I'd know, like, the characters' names by now, but we're only on episode 131, and I feel like that's a 200 episode. So it's gonna punch Asher. It's so mad, yep. And it's so confused about how to strategy, but that is a 33 to hit.
Ooh, it does.
15 damage.
Ow.
And that was the whole turn. It didn't get to make any squares worse for anyone. And Kira is up.
Aha! Kira's gonna follow. Free of difficult terrain. I'll just get right up in its old face. Stand just south of it. And attempt to chainsaw one more time. A different dice. Eh. 27 to hit.
27 hits.
Six, nine, 29 points of damage. Well,
doesn't
I'm
seem
sure
to
it doesn't all go through. Yeah.
But the robot is looking pretty badly damaged at this point. But it's not dead.
Well, that's me.
All right, Alwyn, you're up.
The problem is, like, all of my damage spells, I'm 99% sure don't work on robots because it's, like, the reverse heal ones, which I'm pretty sure don't work on things like that. What can I hit it with? It's not holding anything, so I can't hit it with Burning Disarm. Shake its bones. I can use Make Whole and make this fight last longer. You know what? He's just going to attempt to... Well, it's already confused. Oh, wait, no, it's not, because it went after me. He's going to confuse it again. Make me another will save.
Much better, 27 this time.
It's a level 1 spell. I can cast a lot of those.
27.
What was it? Oh, 27. I said 17. I'm like, no, that still fails. That's a pass, so it's not confused.
All right. It's totally going to get a turn to use that not confusion. Going anywhere? Just hanging out?
He's going to move slightly closer, but still, like, 20 feet away from it.
All right, Brixby.
I'm out of Scorchy Doodles. So, yep, that is a 22 versus Flat-Footed Touch.
That will hit.
All right, as a glob of acid. So, here's the acid damage separately. That's a big, come on, two acid, and 22 sneak attack.
Wow, that's a pretty solid sneak attack roll.
Very focused bit of acid.
But, you know, it's still up. As sneaky as that acid was at hitting its all robotic joints and stuff. Robot is tenaciously clinging to life. And Asher is up.
Yeah, okay. Asher will take a 5-foot step back towards the west. And this battery has conveniently 4 charges left, so we'll just burn it out and do a rapid shot, deadly aim, full attack. Well, we know that one of those is a natural 1. I'll just ignore it. although I don't know if this item can misfire anyway. So that's only three hits, but three hits it is.
I'll roll high on this damage.
Okay. that is 46 points of electric damage.
So really, it is 69 points of electric damage, nice. If my math is right, which is, of course, nice. It had three hit points left.
Excellent.
So as the second robotic apprentice crumbles to the ground at the hands of Asher's plus two EMP pistol that he found in the basement, I'm going to bed.
It's pronounced emp. Good night, Sam.
Good night, Sam.
Good night, Sam.
Against the machine.
Against the Machine is property of Network Against the Machine, LLC, all rights reserved. Pathfinder and the Iron Gods Adventure Path are property of Paizo Publishing. See their website for more details. Theme Against the Machine was written and performed by your own Zach. See the show notes for additional music and sound licensing. If you enjoy the show, we encourage you to leave us a review.
Start
recording now.
Doom, doom, now recording.
Waveforms.
Enrique Iglesias doesn't have a mole anymore.
What? Doesn't have a mole.
What? It was all smoldery, moldery.
Oh.
That's why we can define things into BM and AM. No, wait.
Oh, no. Oh, no. The bowel meridian and the anti meridian.
Great, got it.
One, two, three, clap.
I'm not 12 years old, you're 12 years old. Still gonna laugh at Bal Meridian for days, I think.
It's, without a doubt, it's my the least best favorite Cormac McCarthy book. Oh, come on.
We missed it.
Yeah.